attendees, but also the participants, because I know we will record this and it's going to be a valuable resource for all of us who will still be using, I think, a lot of what we've learned, and hopefully what others can tell us about what they've learned about teaching now almost entirely online. It seems to me to be a very evolving skill set. And I'm always really grateful for not just tips, but even methodologies and more holistic approaches that other people can tell me about. And so this is why we decided to do this webinar. And I'm very grateful to the participants who will be talking to us today. And I think most of you know them, but I will introduce Katherine Pierpont, Chris Saladin, and Loren Cowdery, who are all graduate students in the Department of History and instructors. And they taught together and worked through a lot of this together. And they're going to talk about that with us today. Okay, thanks.
Looks like we had to readmit Katherine, who
was going to start us off. Yes.
Hi, sorry. I was trying to see. It worked. So I had to hop out and hop back in because my video, for some reason, was not working. But if we're ready to start, then I'll just go ahead and get started. So last summer, sort of early on in pandemic times, Loren, Chris, and I were tasked with teaching a class called History 1011, Civilization and the Environment, World History to 1500. So no big deal, just all of human history from, well, actually all of history, because we actually start before modern day humans exist, to 1500. And we had about a month to kind of think about how we wanted to do this. And I'm just going to talk about sort of very basic stuff that we decided first when we were setting up this class. The first thing that we decided was that it was going to be asynchronous. I sort of pushed for this for a couple reasons. One, I believe I was the only one of the three of us who had been teaching during the spring semester during the pandemic. And so I was a little bit like, guys, it's crazy out there trying to teach right now. We wanna keep things simple for our students. And also Chris's section originally had a time attached to it, but neither Loren's nor my section had a time when students enrolled. So sort of the first thing we had to do when we figured out how we wanted to run this class was asynchronous or synchronous, and we ended up going with an asynchronous course. And I kind of felt that that was one of the best ways of ensuring everything was equal for and accessible for everyone, since it was early on in the pandemic and people were just sort of beginning to understand how long the social distancing and isolating was going to go on. It seemed like, you know, that was kind of the driving force behind that. Then we had to figure out how to do that effectively. And so one of the things that I'm going to show is our Canvas page for it. It's actually Chris's Canvas page. We all had our own, but we all had access to each other's Canvas pages. So this is the homepage of our Canvas screen with a course description, our information for the instructors. Each of us was a primary instructor for a different section, and some quick links. And this is kind of what I want to focus on, is we also did the online pedagogy course where you get certified in sort of teaching online. And one of the things that we learned through that was sort of clarity and concision and repetition are the most important aspects to designing a successful online course. For an asynchronous course, we decided that that meant we should kind of do it through these weekly modules. So Canvas has the module set up, and we essentially just set up our course to run as 1 week modules where they had material that they had to cover and assignments that they had to complete. they had to complete their assignments by, you know, 5 p.m. on Sunday, and then 8 a.m. on Monday, the module reset. So this is kind of each week had its little explanation and overview. Again, like repetition of all of the different links that we used, sort of providing, one of the things we talked a lot about was providing different pathways from all the parts of the Canvas page to get to other parts. So, you know, being sure that they could reach their burst lectures from here, but then also that they could reach their burst lectures from, I think it's maybe the files page, or no, it's not the files, maybe it's the syllabus page. We had essentially, you could go to all of the different components for the week from a variety of different places. So the homepage is where we housed it. So if you went down on the homepage, you could kind of just get to whatever it was you needed at a quick glance. And these modules had several different components, which we repeated each week. And we're gonna talk about in a little more detail. We had burst lectures. So those were, we're gonna talk a little bit about those, but those are these quick lecture videos. Each of us created one every week. We had readings that were done via perusal, and that was their material. And then they would have a quiz. So the other material is the podcast, which we'll talk about more as well. And then at the end of all that, they did a quiz and a What's Missing report. The quiz was really low stakes. It was just a quick reading quiz. So they were given two chances to take every quiz, and their highest score was kept, and there was no time limit. So I'm going to hand it over to Chris, who's going to kind of start by talking about how we ran the reading section. So, Chris?
Sure. All right. Thanks. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. And yeah, so hopping on to another week's overview here. If you look at sort of the requirements we have each week, the main, like Katherine was saying, the sort of like main thing they start with are those lectures, which is then attached to the quiz. And then the sort of like second main component every week was the readings. And for this, we have every week we had like the same prompt and everything for just kind of the overview of how they factored into their grade and all that. And then for each week we had the readings posted on this platform, Perusal. And Perusal is basically a, it's like a digital annotation platform where you can sort of post readings and students can simultaneously sort of post different comments and questions in the same space with each other. If you've used Hypothesis at all, it's very similar, but we actually specifically chose to go with Perusal over Hypothesis for a couple different reasons. Kind of the main one was that Perusal just has a lot more functionality. Like you can actually see, you can look at things both from sort of like an assignment view, you can collect their sort of like library of materials that you then put into those assignments. And then the thing I really like about it is this student view, where you can actually go in and select a specific student and see what comments they've made on a reading. Whereas I don't think Hypothesis has that. And the other element is that Perusal actually has a built-in grading function that you can set different criteria that isn't, some of it is sort of like the number of comments, which is kind of the main thing we graded on, sort of like how often are they engaging with this? But there's also other factors with the automatic grading, like how long do they spend looking at a specific page? Or like time in total with the reading versus like the range of pages that they look at. So are they only looking and commenting on the first page, or are they actually like looking through the entire reading? So it gets very detailed. And there are some drawbacks to that, which I'll get to in a sec. But yeah, so basically each week, The first week we kind of loaded them up with readings. We even included the syllabus as one of the required ones. And then from then on, we really tried to just have three a week. Some weeks we still had four. And in each case, they were required to do three comments on each reading. And if I just hop into one of these readings here, you can sort of see how they're able to you can sort of look at it kind of individually by different students. And sometimes they will, like a lot of times, just provide helpful information for each other. Like in this case, like they go in and they actually like look at, they'll go and like look up a term they didn't know or something like that. Or often they'll ask questions specifically or point out general comments. And the whole point of this was to sort of simulate what you would do in a discussion section or in the discussion portion of a class. Of course, it's not the same thing. It's never going to be the same thing trying to do this asynchronously. But I would say that the one big benefit to this style of annotation over having that, I would say like the only thing that I would say worked better than maybe in an in-person discussion is that the students really talked with each other more than just talking at the instructor. Like it never felt like they were just trying to comment to get us to comment back to them. And these maybe are bad examples I'm finding right now, but a lot of the time, because it looks like at this point I was just answering questions on what turned out to be a rather confusing reading. But a lot of times they actually do like talk to each other in these. And I'm, again, I'm not finding that, of course, but, I think there was one there. Yeah. So here, like the students would reply and talk with each other a lot more than necessarily just expecting a response from us or trying to, get it, just sort of appease us with their answers, I guess is what I'm saying. I really like Perusal and I have used it multiple times since. I taught 10-11 again, this same class again in the fall with Elizabeth, who's here. And we used it again, and then Elizabeth's here, right? Yeah. So we used it again, and then I also am using it currently in my Roman history class. So I think it's a great platform. But of course, there are as many benefits as there are, there's also some downsides. I would say, like I said, the main benefits are that students are engaging with each other quite a bit. And then the other big one is just it, in a lot of ways, can force closer reading, or at least in a way you can, I guess I can see the students thinking through the readings more clearly on a specific basis, sort of them really dialing into particular words, particular sentences, which is good, but also has some downsides as well, because that means that maybe the students are engaging with very particular parts, but they sometimes get lost. They get lost in the forest a little bit, looking at the trees in terms of like, I've generally found that they don't necessarily get to the bigger question, like the bigger arguments and points of the readings as much as maybe you would focus on more in an in-person discussion. I find that they really kind of dial in on little things, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. It's just different. But as far as some of the other drawbacks go, the automatic grading I found can be quite inaccurate in terms of sort of, if you're grading for like quality of a student's comment is a very subjective thing. And so when it's an algorithm doing that, it sometimes gets confused. And I found it helpful for guiding me how generally the students were engaged with it. But then I always found myself double checking it almost always. So it's helpful for a quick overview, but it also, I found that I ended up hand grading a decent amount with the student comments. The other big disadvantage is that in some ways, the program has a feeling of almost like policing the students with the way that sort of I'm watching them sort of engaging with particular parts of the reading and making sure that they're, you know, that specifically the grading part, sort of like making sure that they're reading through the whole thing, spending a lot of time. Like it just sometimes,
it allows for a really high level of surveillance in a way that is,
that's a good
like,
way to put it.
You know, if you're thinking about like how policing works in the classroom, perusal is a very surveillance heavy software in terms of the data that it collects about your students and the time they spend on each reading.
Yes. So I think that that ultimately comes down to, if you're relying just on that algorithm and the way it's surveilling them, I don't know what the word is, but versus going through and more just responding to the comments and reading them individually. So like I said, I did teach this class a second time, and a few of the things that we did try to change a bit, and I think I'd even change more going forward, is I think it's just a benefit to have less readings or shorter readings in general. I find the students are much more engaged with them when that's the case. And that's, I feel like, the case with any, that's just teaching in general. And so I think with perusal, I definitely favor the shorter readings. And then the other, like I said, I would try to grade. I now, like with my Rome course, I grade them entirely by hand pretty much. Now, as far as actually replying to all the student questions, because like right now I have like 43 students, and so I can't possibly respond to all of their comments on every reading, or else it like takes an entire day. So I sort of like randomly select them. And the main thing is just making sure that I'm sort of present in the space, making sure that they know I am there sort of looking at these and answering questions. And I try to get to all the students at some point. So anyways, that's kind of the overview of the readings. So pass it off to Loren now, who is going to talk about our last kind of big component, the What's Missing report assignment.
So yeah, so we were talking about what to do for the weekly assignments a lot. Quizzes are fine, but again, we were shooting for low stake quizzes, and we wanted an assignment that would scaffold sort of writing skills and just giving them some feedback on a regular basis, and then get them to sort of reflect on the course as a whole, and that really fit this sort of weekly cadence model that we had. And so I was thinking a lot about it, and I was thinking about a few years ago when I was running teaching the pre-modern research workshop, we had a speaker come out from Western Washington University who talked about an assignment that he did in his course, which is where he has the students read multiple sections of a text, or the same sort of section from multiple textbooks every week, and we'll break it up so that everybody's reading slightly different groups of readings, and have his discussion that way. And then sort of the final paper in that course was to sort of critique a textbook. And I've always found this a really interesting assignment that sort of leans really well into the broad nature of our survey courses, and sort of taking advantage of thinking about what is it that you're being presented with, what gets left out, and why, and these sorts of questions. And so it occurred to me that maybe that's something we could lean into, that we can't do, especially that sort of textbook assignment in the pandemic, because I can't just put a bunch of textbooks on reserve in the library and expect they'll necessarily have access to them in a reasonable manner. And so sort of came up with, I was exploring various digital tools through this online certification course that we were all doing, that we were all required to do. And one of the tools that they talked about was Padlet, and Padlet's this really interesting idea mapping platform. But one of the things that you can do is you can have the ideas put essentially on a timeline. And so it occurred to me that maybe we could get them to do short stake assignments where they sort of think about what got left out of the week's material, and put it on a timeline and sort of get a good opportunity to sort of visualize, you know, the time, the temporal scope of the course, what we did for the week, and that we can even link this sort of weekly report into the final paper by having them make a case, not necessarily a question about history, but making a case for why a particular topic that was left out should in fact have been covered in the course, as a way to get them to think about the course as a whole, to think about what they're being presented with. In addition to Padlet, we did Survey 123, which Chris then collated into story maps, and I'll let him talk about that if he wants in a bit. He is, of course, the map guru of CLA. So in terms of where it fits within the course, again, sort of circling back to that sort of weekly cadence, what we were really looking for in this assignment when we created it was, it's a low stakes assignment. It's something that they do every week that gets them to practice various writing skills and various historical analytical skills without it being a make or break like a bigger paper. The other sort of key things here that we were looking for and that we sort of built into the assignment as we constructed it was we wanted the short iteration cycle so that every week they would get some feedback on what they were doing and how they can improve, and that this would have them practice certain skills of research and writing and explaining that then would go into the final paper, sort of scaffolding some of those skills and getting them an opportunity to practice it. So in terms of what the assignment actually looked like on a week-to-week basis, this is sort of the prompt that we were using and broken down to its constituent parts. I would love to take credit for this sort of layout. I can't. This really just was ripped off from that online certification course in terms of the layout. We thought it was a pretty good layout and adapted it pretty readily. You know, sort of a section where you can sort of know just what the assignment is and sort of connect it to the various course learning goals. Especially in an online course, we thought it was really important to make it really painfully, overly detailed, clear how to do this assignment and the various steps they go through in the order and even some cautions to how not to complete the assignment. We also provided various resources. I took them out of this because if I left those links in for what we were doing every week, I could not fit this on a single slide. I don't think I could fit it on three slides. But we had various links to museum exhibits that students could explore digitally, primary sources, some secondary sources, some introductory sources, Britannica, Wikipedia sort of things, for just sort of very broad stuff for the week that sort of, you know, here is a place to start to begin looking for and exploring things that might be missing. And we also provided them with an assignment template of this is what this should look like every week, you know. It's here in the prompt. There was a Word document version they could download. There was a Google Doc version they could go and get. And so that there was no reason that their prompts or their reports wouldn't look and be correctly formatted, which I have to say worked actually very, very well. The students actually did very, very well with that particular aspect of it. The last step would be to upload their reports to Padlet and Survey123. And then sort of circle back at the end and pick a report and then sort of write a final paper about why that particular topic should be covered. It's sort of a twinned and entwined assignment. The core of the assignment, really the core thing that we were looking for and that we graded them on, was that we wanted them to pick a topic that we had left out and explain why that topic was significant, explain its historical significance. Because that would be the thing that sort of fleshed out more in the final paper.
Particularly as it related to the theme, because that was the thing that we tried to hit pretty hard, was it's a class about civilization and the environment. So if you think we should include the Vikings, we did talk about the Vikings, but like if we didn't include the Crusades and you think we need to talk about the Crusades, explain why in relation to the environment, in relation to a course about civilization and the environment, that matters.
So thinking about outcomes, we thought the assignment was really successful overall. It was the first time we piloted. It had some rough parts to it. And I'll talk a little bit about those and things that we will change. But that one of the things that we really saw was that the short iteration cycles allowed students who put the time to see our feedback and consider it to begin producing some truly impressive work by the end of the course. And this is one of the sample reports that came out. And this is probably, from my section, I think one of the best reports in the entire class. That the student did a really good job of identifying something we didn't talk about, identifying its significance, not only for understanding that moment in time, but for how we think about the past. And so there was, for a number of students, a really stark and startling improvement over the course of this 8-week course. That was very impressive. There were, of course, you know, some students just didn't bother to really look at our feedback, which is a perennial problem in teaching that I'm sure all of us are familiar with, alongside the problem of just some students just trying to give a right answer to move on with it, and rather than stopping and reflecting that we were asking them to do. But overall, we felt like the assignment was very good. It was well received. It was fun. We felt it was very effective. One of the most interesting thing and fun things about the assignment, as it turned out, was that, you know, we got the students to really meaningfully contribute to the course material. They built a timeline that takes a good amount of effort to scroll through and look at. They had, you know, 8 weeks worth of story maps where all these different what's missing topics were at, and they could see both in time and space what was not being covered. We saw a lot of general improvement of critical thinking skills, especially thinking about historical significance and articulating it. I wouldn't go so far as to say mastery of that skill, but I think for a 1,000 level course, that's fine. I don't think we're asking them necessarily master that, but to be introduced to it and improve in that skill. That would be my take on that. You know, we got students to really successfully inhabit the role of the historian in creating the historical content, hearing these reports, and this was really reinforced with the final paper project, where they were asked to sort of make the case for what should be covered in this class that we are doing right now. What did we not cover that they think that we really should have covered? And there were a couple of those papers that have made us pause and rethink some of the course content and to maybe go back and include those things. Students were very readily brought in things that we left out. I mean, we were upfront with them that we couldn't cover everything, but that was a fool's errand, and that we're going to try to provide them a really solid course and content, but that there are things we're not going to talk about. And so they talked about the Americas. They talked about Australia. They talked about China when we didn't. The week that we didn't talk about the Greeks, really, they came in and fleshed out the Greeks particularly well.
They were not happy about the Greeks being left out.
We tried really hard to make it not about the Greeks.
I think by the end of the course, it was really clear, like, the sheer scope of what the course attempts to do was made clear to them, and they appreciated what that was, and how, in many ways, this was a very surface level skim through all of this material. It was very much an introduction to, and not a comprehensive class. I think in terms of refining, we would say go with a single platform. Trying to do ARC story map and Padlet is cumbersome and logistically challenging. We would want to do better scaffolding around how to explain historical significance, and also pull that out as a separate part of the grading rubric, rather than folding that into Clarity like we had. That was a mistake on our part. We would also make the approval of topics for the final paper, of selecting a report for a final paper, a more robust process to help avoid overly narrow or overly broad topics. And we would probably tweak some of the source requirements. We had them cite sources. There's some different views on what this might be. We've talked about a couple different versions of this. I think for me, I would move to a triple source requirement and have one of them be an introductory type source, a Britannica, a Wikipedia. If you're not familiar with this is a quick place to get your feet grounded really quick. And then a sort of a more scholarly source, an article or a monograph on it, as well as then a primary source related to the topic. to get them to practice those research skills, those citation skills, and sort of think about the different levels of knowledge that are produced. And me and Chris talked a little bit about this earlier this week. It would be really nice to be able to have a reflection moment to sort of on the timeline, the story maps, to think about what was produced and the trends within it. The feasibility of that in a fully online asynchronous course is probably hard. It would be a great last day right before evals in an in-person course, which I already do a sort of timeline exercise typically.
Also in an 8-week summer course, which is what this originally was, it's harder to build in that time.
So hard.
Yeah. I will add that some of the suggestions for future changes that Laura mentioned, we actually did implement in the fall when I taught this with Elizabeth. We did end up like, we did end up, for example, like making one of the specific questions they had to like answer each week specifically about historical significance, and also not just significance in general, but how it connected to the main themes of the class. So it did narrow that a bit. And then as far as sources go, we also did require one secondary and one primary source each time. And then we had an option for an additional source, which is usually where they put Wikipedia. I think I would next time move towards actually having that be like a required, like tertiary kind of source. But yeah, I think that overall, yeah, the assignment worked well. And I'll also reemphasize the choose one platform thing, because I did that the second time around. We did it with just with Survey 1, 2, 3, and then uploaded those into a story map for each week. One story map with a section for each week. And I think that worked pretty well. I would say ultimately just choose the platform you're most comfortable with. If you're not comfortable messing with GIS data, then don't make yourself do it. I would say go with there's arguments for both the timeline and the map, which Lauren and I have had those discussions.
I think it was a really great assignment that kind of just, I was pleasantly surprised by papers that clearly came from places where students felt like they had a stake in the class, not just in terms of the class that they experienced, but the class that it could potentially be going forward. Because, you know, we were all very upfront with our students. Like, if you make a good argument, it's entirely possible that you will convince me. And so it was really interesting to see students, you know, not everyone, but quite a few of them really stake a claim for their understanding of the theme and also their understanding of using different sources and understanding like past relationships with environment versus present. It was really cool. I am going to, since I see that we have already had some questions in the chat, I'm gonna talk a little bit about the other two components that we created, which were the burst lectures and our podcast, which was actually more like a video cast. So we essentially, and I am on my new computer, which I only got after I finished recording all of these burst lectures. So there's an annoying high-pitched whine faintly in the back of all my burst lectures. But we used a software that you can get free through the university called Screencast-O-Matic. I am far and away the least technologically capable of the three of us. I am a technophobe in the truest sense of the word. It is not that I don't like technology. It is that I fear it because I don't understand how to use it. But I found Screencast-O-Matic incredibly intuitive. It doesn't mean that maybe I got everything out of it that you could get. I'm sure with someone who's a little more technologically capable, there's like a lot of really crazy things you can do. But for just, you know, videoing myself lecturing and then being able to go back and cut out pieces or add pieces. I found Screencast-O-Matic totally sufficient for what I needed and very intuitive. It lets you kind of, it lets you share your screen while also having a little talking head so you can lecture and show a slide show at the same time. So I can kind of show, if I pull up, we can check out a burst lecture, which would, what a delight, what week to do. What was week three? All right. So you see they're all embedded. So I saw Kay asked in the chat if we use Kaltura. We didn't use Kaltura for recording. I don't think any Loren of us did. Loren did. Okay, so Loren can talk about that a bit. I think he ended up switching, but we did use it as an upload platform. So essentially, like, how do we get these videos cleanly integrated to Canvas? And the answer is you can upload it to My Media on Kaltura. And then Kaltura also will embed in a Canvas page. So you can, I'm trying to see if I have it here. You can actually like click up here, like you can insert media and it will ask you like where you want it from and if you want it from Kaltura and stuff. So it integrates really nicely from Canvas, but it was not, as I recall, a particularly great software for actually recording. I was gonna show really quickly, you know, like all of this was done on Screencast-O-Matic, so I could kind of like show this opening, like we're gonna talk about Orientalism and its problems. And then you can, you know, there's the video of me talking and here is the slideshow. And the key with the burst lectures was that we, well, it wasn't always successful, but the aim was for 20 minutes. The aim was always for 20 minutes. That between the three of us, it shouldn't be over an hour. Each of us will give a 20 minute lecture on whatever topic we are doing. And yeah, YouTube always blocked videos with music. Or any pop culture references. So that's why that didn't work super well. But this kind of gave the students a way of like engaging in quick hits, which I think is really helpful in general. It's something that I try and do in my classes, even if they're synchronous or in person, is sort of provide a little bit of lecture time and then give them time to think about that and maybe talk or engage, rather than just having them sort of be inundated with information. Studies have shown that it's really hard for people to focus over those very long periods of time. So the burst lectures are meant to be a way to not ask them to be glued to their screen for like a full hour, totally paying attention. I think also I was very conscious, we sent out a survey at the beginning of class as a little bit of a check-in, asking anyone who is willing to share anonymously, you know, do you have a quiet space to work? How often do you have access to a quiet space to work? Do you have stable internet? How often do you have access to stable internet? And are you an essential worker? And 30% of our students were essential workers. So this was another thing that it occurred to me is, you know, a 20 minute lecture is something that a student can fit in sort of an in-between time. And so if they're really stressed out and there's a lot going on and they have to get to a shift, they're not sort of stopping in the middle of a longer lecture. They're watching a full lecture with a thesis and an argument, absorbing it and then moving on. And when they come back, they can kind of pick up on the next lecture. And I think, Chris, were you gonna talk about how much like the 20 minute lecture forces you to make your points really clearly and concisely?
I can mention that for sure. Yeah, no, it I will say writing, I found that actually writing a 20 minute lecture that is very concise and has very thorough notes is much more work than having a more loosely based longer lecture. with just slides, because I would actually write a script every time, just to like keep it concise and keep myself on task and make sure it covered everything. But I was actually going to mention that something that I don't remember if Loren touched on this fact when he was talking about the What's Missing report, but because our burst lectures were so short, obviously we left a lot of content out and we were skipping through a lot of material. We were flying kind of big picture over a lot of things. And that is what was one of our main incentives for the What's Missing report, was so yeah. they would fill in the details and sort of build the historical narrative with us.
And I think at times, I know I did, I think Chris did, and it contravenes a little bit, but it incentivizes them to engage in the work sooner and in its entirety, because at times one of us would maybe leave a teaser kind of at the end of a video being like, I can't talk about this, it's super interesting and cool, I hope someone does a What's Missing report on it. So you could kind of be like, there's this other thing happening over here that I just don't have time to get into. But they weren't allowed to do the same What's Missing report. So as they all created this long timeline, if I said, I don't have time to get into the myth of You the Great, but it would make a great What's Missing report, whoever watched that video first and decided to do that first, nobody else could do it after that. So because they would see like, oh, my classmate already did a What's Missing report on You the Great. And so it was also like a little bit of like Easter eggs for the students to find and engage with, to be able to be like, oh, this is, I started my work early and I've watched the lecture all the way to the end. And Katherine, in fact, included a slide that had like, you know, that was just a slide at the very end at the pause screen that said things I was really excited about and couldn't include. And it was like, run free, you know? And what was cool is that I found that they didn't always take me up on that, which I liked, because it felt very much like this is an option if you're feeling stressed about where to start, but they clearly didn't feel beholden to that. Or feel like I was giving them a direct, you know, prompt, which was great. I was really great that at that point we had managed to sort of convey the spirit in which something like that would be done, which is, these are things that I think are cool, and you might think they're cool too. And we had also recorded introduction videos. So when I say, you know, these are things that I think are cool, they know that that's coming from a medieval historian who studies sex and gender in France, and, you know, a person with a cat who's doing crafts and these other things. Like, they had a little bit of knowledge about who I was and whether or not they thought, you know, if this is a list of things I'm interested in and you're really interested in military history, you maybe actually want to go search on your own for things to find, because it's probably not in my list. Our introduction videos were kind of an attempt at making ourselves more accessible for them, and introducing ourselves as not only scholars, but people. Chris famously filmed his in a canoe on a river in Missouri. Loren, were you gonna jump in?
Yeah, I was going to say, I went a different route with mine. I didn't tend to leave things in my slideshows. I did a lot of digging around and putting in the resources. And so I would find lots of random resources that, like, if you look through them and you click on them, you're going to find things that aren't covered that I didn't talk about.
I engaged in a little bit of both. I would leave things in the lectures, but then also, yeah, add to the resources.
And I was gonna say just really quickly that the last thing we did was our podcast, which was so much fun, mostly I think for us, because essentially every week after we finished doing the readings, we would all get together and have a chat, and we would just be like, all right, so you can see this one's taking on the role of the historian with primary sources. So this was us kind of trying to model for them how we wanted them to approach primary sources. And it was really fun. So I'm gonna play it complete with the intro music, because the intro music is great.
During the first millennium, and it's based on,
so this was essentially what it was the three of us very consciously being historians but also individuals, right? We have someone from Missouri, someone from New York, someone from Washington, very different scholars, very different individuals, and we all got together for, I mean, we normally bracketed off an hour to an hour and a half for like the time it took us to record it. And then bless his soul, Chris would edit it down to somewhere between 35 to 45 minutes. And this was, again, I think one of the things that really scares people about asynchronous teaching is that it feels so impersonal. And how do you make connections with students when you never have to spend time with them? And I think the biggest thing is to remember that your lectures are actually a way that you're spending time with them and they're spending time with you. And so we always kind of tried to make those accessible. And this was another way of humanizing things so that, you know, if you read your lecture and maybe really needed to get content across, you could still get opinions and ideas and jokes and other things in. And bring some of that humanity to the classroom through the podcast, particularly because Loren, Chris, and I are all friends, and we are also all, well, particularly Loren and myself, are hard-headed individuals. And so our podcasts weren't just the three of us agreeing about things. And one of the things that we wanted to do was say, you know, the production of knowledge is not a solo endeavor. There isn't one right answer. And here's how the sausage gets made. It's me and Chris and Loren arguing about, you know, when does the Middle Ages start, and me revising my terrible opening statement of like Charlemagne halfway through and being like, no, I take that back. It's totally the rise of Islam. And just being like, all right, leave that in the podcast, right? That's like, that's what these conversations are.
And also, just to add to that, the three of us are very different historians, just in how we approach things in general, what things we're concerned with. And I think that came across very clearly. And that was probably the most important lesson of the whole thing, as Catherine's been insinuating. This is about how historical knowledge gets produced differently and how we're thinking through these things.
Yeah, and that, you know, the person you are changes how you think about things. And I think that that was probably the part that students really vibed with too, was the podcast as like a mode of sort of picking apart a theme. If the burst lectures and the readings were about providing content, the podcast was, let's hold discussion section as best we can with the three of us. So I know we've chattered on for a really long time. So I'm wondering if Michelle wants to solicit any questions.
Yeah, I'm happy to. I know people have been asking, including myself, questions in the chat, because there were a couple times something got mentioned. I was like, I'm gonna forget if I wait, so I'll put it in writing. But I don't know. Kay had some questions. I don't know.
Well, I sort of overwhelmed you with my questions in the chat. This sounds like an extremely rich course. I mean, with, you know, three minds are better than one, I think, and this combination of talents must have made it extraordinary. If Chris said that he had 43 students, does that mean that the course had 120 or thereabouts enrolled?
Well, that was a different class.
But, yeah, this class had 60 to 65.
65, that's still significant. And it was writing intensive. Is it the 10-11 writing intensive version? Yeah. But when it gets taught, I mean, I assume that you would be using the lectures that were created by all three of you in subsequent versions of the course. Thus, Chris, when you and Elizabeth taught, I assume that the wisdom of Katherine and Loren were part of your toolbox. I mean,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were frequent guest speakers.
which also was really...
Exactly. Well, it very exciting. I have worked hard just to sort of get a handle on Canvas and the idea of introducing all of these other softwares or whatever platforms, Perusal, etc., into Padlet. I'm not even know what that is. Into the process sort of boggles the mind.
Me too, Kay. I had a lot of help on that front. That also for me was a lot to deal with.
But it should be a course taught every summer. And Katherine, you're going to teach it, right?
So Loren and I are doing it again this summer, which is really exciting.
Okay. Well, it is an extremely ambitious course. And I think that there would be two of you rather than just you alone is great. I'm one of those who would be very hesitant to do anything asynchronous because I find the synchronous teaching online rewarding, and the amount of it that I've done, it did allow me to get a sense of the students. A number of them, would contribute questions in the chat, et cetera. I agree that there's a clunky dimension to discussions in the Canvas site, but again, sort of my immediate reaction would be to use the options in that site and not to introduce all of these other dimensions, although clearly they're enriching. But I think it's a kind of model that we really ought to, keep alive, shall we say, for subsequent offerings. Felicitaciones, congratulations. It was great.
Yeah, it was. I mean, I think that Kay, much like you, I, without having two people to sort of help guide me with technology suggestions, I probably would have fallen back a lot on Canvas. I will say, having used some of these other stuff, other things, it's hard to go back to Canvas now because it is lacking. And I will say, luckily, the students didn't seem to have huge problems with our technological demands, which was a thing that I was concerned about and brought up. And they seemed to really be able to wrap their head around how the software for these different things work.
Your modules, you obviously set it up in a very organized way. I mean, that came through loud and clear in the courses I took last summer, that it has to be extremely carefully laid out so that people don't get lost. But you indicated in my chat response that Perusal didn't mesh with Canvas very easily. Can you talk about that? I mean, Perusal seems really intriguing.
So the main issue, and I know Laura knows more about this maybe, but the main issue with Perusal and Canvas is that it has not been approved for integration. And the CLA instead chose to go with Hypothesis, which is a similar software, which is now integrated with Canvas, I believe. And if you're hesitant about going outside of Canvas, I recommend looking more into Hypothesis.
Hypothesis, yeah, okay.
So that's the main thing, is that it doesn't, go with Canvas in that it's just it's a totally separate platform and they have to be linked out to it. But once they become familiar with it after the first couple of weeks, it doesn't seem to be a big deal.
Yeah. Yeah, I was also gonna say, just speaking of frequent guest visitors, is one of the really cool things that we got to do doing the podcast is we also invited people to guest podcast with us, particularly because we reached a certain point in time, you get past the 12th century and none of us know what's happening. So, you know, we invited, and because we'd done the colloquium, we got Pablo Gomez to come talk about, you know, the Atlantic Trade Network and how that affects environment and disease and, you know, conquest and things like that. So, you know, I know you've talked about this before, Kay. It's another way and another really easy way to integrate other scholars to come in and talk without needing them to be there and without it feeling like they're on a screen and you're not. So that was also really fun.
And the podcast linked with Canvas easily.
Yes. Okay. So the podcast was uploaded. I think we ended up uploading using Kaltura by the end. And you could just embed it directly into the Canvas page. So like, if you look at this page that I'm sharing, you haven't even left Canvas. You can just watch it on the Canvas page.
Great.
Setting up class and weekly preparing materials. Yeah. I would say this is the thing I'm most looking forward to with running the class again, is that I will have more time to not just be recording lecture. I would say it's a steep learning curve in terms of, at least for me, I can't speak for everyone else, but it feels like if you're able to work to make your lecture perfect, then you should, but you shouldn't. I say this especially to the grad students out there, don't stop and re-record every time you stutter. One of the things that I got really used to doing, so I don't write my lectures out, I give myself notes and then just kind of talk. And one of the things that I got really used to doing was I got a sense, at a certain point you get a clear sense of how many pages of notes or writing for you is 20 minutes. And so then I didn't even have to like worry about recording until I was within that sort of page frame. And then instead of stopping and restarting, one of the things I really liked about Screencast-O-Matic is it's super easy to cut a chunk out. So if I sort of had transitioned into like, all right, now we're talking about this new thing, and then I messed up, I would give myself a nice long pause, because in Screencast-O-Matic, it will show you where there are silences. I would give myself a nice long pause so that when I looked at the lecture, I would see where that silence was. And then I'd just start, you know, I'd back myself up 10 seconds or something and start again. And I'd just record the whole thing. And maybe I'd end up with a 35 minute video, but maybe 10 minutes of that was actually just those stutter steps and I would just cut them out. And then another 5 minutes of sort of smaller editing, which I actually kind of liked the editing. I found it a little bit cathartic at the end of all of it. But I would say for the first few times I was recording, it took a couple hours because mostly it wasn't preparing the class content. It was actually doing the recording and the editing.
I mean, that's helpful. So that was like your weekly as you're going. The materials you had set up for the course looked like it just took a lot of time. Like the weekly setup and then those prompts you have finding, you know, getting all those sources in. I was just trying to imagine, like, as an individual, like, I'm going to do this class. Like, do I need a whole month?
to set this up? The good and bad thing is that obviously there were three of us, so there was like a nice division of labor here. And uh, because it was module based, it was a lot of just copy and paste most of this same stuff from week to week. It's kind of the annoying thing about Canvas that Loren and I have talked about recently, is it really doesn't want to just copy things. It wants you to individually input, even if you're just putting the same thing in over and over. But we set up our Canvas page as much as possible ahead of time. And we had scheduled weekly emails that went to our classes. So every Monday it was like, here's an email of everything that's going on this week and your links. And every Friday it was like, come Sunday, you know, this is what you need to have submitted. Don't forget. And then on Monday it'd be like, here's the week that you're looking at. And I think that this is, it's also good to do that for online, particularly asynchronous classes, because students, for some reason, none of them can check both their email and their Canvas. You get like 50% of them are Canvas only and 50% of them are email only. And I don't know why, but this was a good way of sort of catching everyone.
Yeah, something else. I don't remember if we, I'm sure that we mentioned it, but one really crucial thing was the fact that everything was due on the same day every week.
And at the same time.
Yeah, so all of the material was due Sunday nights, everything for the entire week. So the whole week was treated as a module instead of us trying to like throw things in throughout the week.
So you did that on a week to week basis. It wasn't because it, no. We're looking at the final project and I'm like, did you guys all meet for several weeks and put all of this content together and map it out and have all the resources in there? And
no, we had like our Canvas set up really well ahead of time. But in terms of burst lectures and podcasts, we were about a week ahead of the students the whole time. So we were essentially doing week four while they were going through week three's materials. But we tried to put as much of the like infrastructure on Canvas and stuff together just because we knew we had like the month of May to put all this together from when we found out we would all be teaching it together. And so like, we were sort of like throwing that in as we went and adding resources and stuff. And I would say that some of that resource stuff, Loren, correct me if I'm wrong, I would assume some of that was stuff you encountered or were looking at while you were prepping lecture material. Yeah, Loren did so much of the scaffolding. I really cannot emphasize enough.
Yeah, that document you showed, or that sample, Loren, that is like, you know, very detailed. And, you know, I know they said this is what it should look like in those summer classes, but it's a really developed thing. And so I was wondering if you guys all sat down and did that prior to the class starting, because that stuff takes me forever to do.
Yeah, we did some of it. We created a Google Doc and we're bouncing and commenting and sort of doing
huge, we have a big shared Google folder that was great, and that we also put like broke down to like recordings and content and prompts, so we would go back and forth on you know. And Loren did like all of the scaffolding, and when it came to the prompts, it was usually like one of us manned up and like did the prompt and then invited the others to sort of collaborate, and then it just depended on who at that moment had the time.
Great. Well, this has been really, really helpful. I have a lot of ideas. Yes. I don't know.
Very rich.
Yeah, and it's after 5, so I don't want to abuse you guys, your time. And I know we all want a release from Zoom in the evening, or at least I could be projecting. But I will thank you guys. And I know everybody knows everybody, so you can further, you know, ask questions on email if you have. I'll offer for you guys, but
yeah, I was gonna say Elizabeth, Elijah, and Kara were the only people who weren't someone I've co-instructed with or my advisor who attended. So feel free to get in touch. I guess for recording purposes, if anybody has a question, my email address is pierp009@umn. So that way when we post this, if anyone wants, they can email.
Great. All right. Well, thank you. This was very helpful, and it does sound like it was a great class. So thank you.
Thank you.
I'll just applaud in person. All right.